Let me say a pleasant good evening and welcome everyone to this Thanksgiving service. We are here this afternoon to pay tribute to Kellon Batiste, and I want to say on behalf of the family, the Batiste family, his wife, Miss Connice Batiste, son Kiel, and other extended members of the family, we wish you a warm welcome. And we are here not to sympathize only, but as I said, we are celebrating the life of Kellon. And doing so this afternoon, we have a number of persons who would like to pay tribute, expressing the life of Kellon, the kind of person he was when he was on this earth living. We are being restricted by time. I'm going to let you know, I'm being just reminded there, because we have to move at a time with the police coordinating everything. But before I call the first person, I want to say that as a past employee of the Grenada Airports Authority myself, Kellon worked down there for 25 odd years. I recall when he came in as a young lad within the maintenance department. It was a time when they was building the maintenance complex, which housed the garage, the buildings division of which he's attached to, he was attached to, and of course the plumbing. And as a young lad, you know, he was very zealous and a jovial person, and up to his lifetime, very jovial. I recall him as a person who will speak his mind. And that's one of the things I admired him for, the frankness. You know, and the week of independence, the Monday and Tuesday, I visited the airport. And he said, "Mr. Nash, you'll be on the committee for organizing the oil long this year." I said, "No problem." He said, "Let's come up with a figure." You know, I said, "Well, we can't go with the soft plates, so we are going to use the aluminium bowls. So we're looking at roughly at $20 per person." The Wednesday I had to go back for us to finalize everything. And of course, the rest is history. Wednesday morning, got a call saying that Kellon has passed. To me, it was a shock, because I saw him the Monday, the Tuesday, and I said, "Tomorrow when I come around, we'll finalize everything for the oil long. Who has to organize the bread food, the pigtail, whatever?" It did not really bring a damp, but it's just I was not involved anymore. Because sadness came. Though it was joy, sadness. And like I said, you know, a person that I've admired, a level of closeness, not only to him but to the family, I want to say he's no longer here with us. He's in a better place, and I will remember him for the kind of a jovial person he was, an organizer. I did something in my home a Sunday before. I make sure I got two rabbits. I burnt it and I say, "Masap, I eaten a rabbit today in your name." One of his good friends, I passed on half of it to him. And when I was eating, I said, "You're no longer here with me, my brother, but I'm having a rabbit in your name." Because Masap would have just organized a rabbit, call us, and said, "Listen, just put some money, let's get the rice." And that's the kind of a person he was. So even if I was not at the airport, I was still close with them because of the connection and the socializing that we all have. And this is what life is about. Not just living. We give God thanks every day. But at the same time, we have to make sure that we live well with our peers, that we socialize and we can harmonize ourselves to take away some of the stress that we will have. And this is the person I'll remember him for. The kind of a person that wants to share love, that always believes in socializing. This is why I went out personally and had a rabbit eaten in the name of Kellon mass of baptism. So that's my end. We have a number of persons, like I said this afternoon, who will be paying tribute to Kellon. And I will call the first person, Mr. Randy Boyd Cadet, who is, I understand, is a very close friend, to come and do his bit of tribute.
This is the day that the Lord has made. I know it's tough. I know it's real tough. But let us try to rejoice and be glad in it. Kellon, our comrade, our friend, our brother, we are here to celebrate your life and the measure of its worth and every single life you touched while you were here on this earth. We wish to pay our last respects. That's why we are all here. To thank you for your friendship and all the memories that we hold dear. It's been a privilege to have known you. We were like family, not just friends. And we carry with you in spirit until we meet up once again. Boy, oh boy, little did we know that day that God will call your name. In life, we loved you dearly. In death, we do the same. It broke our hearts to lose you, but you did not go alone. For part of us went with you the day God called you home. You left us beautiful memories. Your passion is still our guide. And though we cannot chill, talk, relax with you, we know your spirit is at our side. Our earthly chain may be broken, and nothing seems the same. But as God calls us one by one, that chain will certainly link again. Rest in eternal peace, my brother. Thank you.
I will now call on Sterling Campbell to do his or her tribute. Sterling. Is Sterling on the outside? Okay, we'll move on. Denzel Batiste, who is a nephew of Kellon. Can you come forward, please, and do your tribute session?
Good afternoon, everybody. Well, I'm here today to pay tributes to my uncle, Kellon, who I usually call Masop. Growing up with Masop was quite fun. He'll usually play cricket with us. He actually taught us how to fish and so on. I was the one that was into hunting, so I never went hunting with he and Chevron and so on. But Masop was always one that will always speak his mind. People will say he's might bad. I like that about him. Because hiding the truth from people actually is lying to them. So I like that about Kellon. Now, I remember growing up, me and my cousin Shem, we went to a body party and we had a little fight with one of the boys that was in the party. And Kellon asked us, on our way home, if we had behaved in the party, and we told him yes. About 20 minutes after, Kellon came home and he said, I thought all they say, all they behave in the party. Me and Shem say, yeah, we behave. And Kellon say, all they lying, man. And he just started giving me and Shem some lash. Kellon was always a strict uncle. He was actually the strictest uncle in all. And I would say he actually allowed me to walk along the straight and narrow path towards goodness. When I joined the Royal Grenada Police Force, Kellon was always there asking me, how are you doing? How are training going? How was training? And whenever something came up, say, don't afraid, Denzel, just charge them. See, once they break the law, just charge them. I say, nah, man. But Kellon, I was so surprised to hear that Kellon had passed away, because the Monday, we left home together, and the following day, while sleeping, I think, either Tuesday or the Wednesday morning, they called me and told me that Kellon died. So I was like, oh, y'all can tell me Kellon died. And me and Master was just talking, so it was kind of surprising me. But what I miss most about Kellon is that you never hold back from telling somebody whatever you want to tell them. Even if you have to tell him, you might go put you in trouble, Masop. He will always say it. And I just love that about him. Masop would always say that he's the best father. Kiel is the best son. He had the best wife, Karnis. Masop. Sad way to go.
Thank you very much, Denzel. I'm still opening the floor for Sterling Campbell. Okay. Seems as though Sterling is not around. Within the organization where Masop once worked, I must say that the Grenada Airport Authority is of about family. I'm speaking of a past as well. Today, to pay tribute, the organization, I understand, has a number of tributes. We have sitting with us the general manager, who is Mrs. Joan Gilbert, the HR manager, and you will recognize the complement of staff. So I'll now call on the Grenada Airport, the general manager and her staff, to come and do their tribute to the late Kellon Batiste. Mr. Gilbert?
Everybody. It is said the Lord gave and the Lord took it away. Lord, I'm not questioning you, but I just think something went wrong along the way. I'm not saying Kellon is deserving of everybody else, but just imagine, I think the evening we spoke, we laugh, we giggle, we joke, and then at 3 o'clock to be waking to tell me, you know, Kellon passed away. Well, I told, I think Glenn who called Forsyth, I said, no man, I think you have the wrong person, you have the wrong number. You have the wrong number, it cannot be Kellon, and today I still cannot believe it's him. Kellon was a good employee, but besides that, he was a good soul, a good friend that I've known for years. And today, he's transitioning, I assume, is a better place, but it has left a vacuum I'm not sure anybody could fill. To his family, I hope you find comfort throughout the way. And then along the way, God will guide and protect you. To the airport staff, I know it has been hard and it has been rough on us, but I really trust that God will continue to guide us and give us that additional strength. I know members of the team had rendition, so I'll ask them to come forward, please. Members of the choir, can you come forward, please?
1, 2. 1, 2, 1, 2.
Gone but not forgotten. Don't think of him as gone away. His journey is just begun. Life holds so many facets. This earth is only one. Just think of him as resting from the sorrows and the tears in a place of warmth and comfort where there are no days and years. Think of how he must be wishing that we could know today how nothing but our sadness can really pass away. And think of him as living in the hearts of those he touched, for nothing loved is ever lost, and he was loved so much.
When I am done,
Sorry, just let me make an announcement, please. Remember the protocols for COVID, and we're asking the persons blocking the door, please leave room so persons can see as well as come in and out. Okay? So please observe that. Thank you. You may go ahead. Very much. Is Denzel here? Sorry, Sterling. Okay, before we move on, we'll continue with the Grenada Airports Authority, and I will call on Mr. Glenn Forsythe,
who is a manager of maintenance within the organization, to bring his tribute. Let's step outside.
Good afternoon, all. I find everybody look dead. Good afternoon, all. Afternoon. Wonderful. So much just there, so little time. Before I go on, I'd like to acknowledge the presence of the new representative for the area, Mr. Nimrod. I honestly don't know where to start, because I was introduced as the manager of maintenance. But long before that, Kellon was a co-worker and eventually became my personal friend. He has been employed at the organization for over 24 years. I have been there longer. And we have been friends for 24 years, or just about. Kellon has touched the lives of most of us, I would say, all of us at MBIA. And thankfully so, in a very positive way. While he may have been attached or was attached to the maintenance department, he has been interaction with employees from every other department. The composition of the choir made up for this occasion demonstrates that there are persons from various departments. I'm very proud in the circumstances to say that as a gentleman who came from a poor, humble background, has been able to touch the lives of so many of us in a very positive way. Thankfully so, he has been able to do so by being himself. As I said, so much to say. I mean, looking back from the days when we had not just work to do, but we socialized along the way. Kellon has not been ashamed or been very proud to speak of his community for one, his wife, his family. Earlier on, I think it's his nephew had made a contribution, and he said Kellon believed that he has the best son, the best wife, the best family. He also believes that the airport is the best place to work. And he always said, but Willis is the best place on earth. Willis is the best place. In that light, I've been able to meet a lot of persons from Willis because of Kellon's experiences and his introduction. It would have been difficult for me to pass through Willis, even now that since after the road and Molina had got broken, once you go up to the, especially we using a heavy truck, you'll have to pass this side. And at times I'd pass, I just hoping that Kellon is not to the side, because if I pass and you don't stop to say hi, you'll be disappointed. He was the kind of individual that even if you may not necessarily agree on certain things, you can discuss. I applaud him for the fact that I was his boss, if you want to call it that. The organization has rules, regulations. And even if a new rule or some instruction has taken place and he did not necessarily agree up front, we can meet outside of work and discuss it. I respect him for the fact that although he was boss, outside of work, we talk anything, we discuss anything. During work time, he was able to separate, this is my friend. Outside of work, this is my manager and my boss in work. And I really wish, well, further more employees can take that example from Kellan's speech. My family as well, extended cousins, for example, when it passed, I mentioned in a group family chat that my friend Kellan had passed. And my sister in New York, who has been away for probably 15, 20 years, was able to, or my brother as well, who has been out for a while, has been able to remember. I didn't have to give him any much explanation. I know I have a cousin who is in Abu Dhabi, you know, Jason. And when he's here, he always asks you, what's about Kellan? Because he knew the kind of friendship and relationship we had over the years. In terms of working within his department, he had a very good relationship. Well, I'll see everybody. He likes to make fun of probably serious things at times. But he just have a nice way of connecting with persons, really nice way of connecting with persons. And it's I don't want to call it it's a loss, because the Lord Jesus Christ knows, and he knows why. But he's no longer with us, but I believe and I am confident that at least his spirit will live on with us in a very positive way. All this morning, probably I got up after 4, and I can't go back and sleep. I said, well, look what Kellan doing to me now. I try to close my eyes. I see what it is. You know, Allen, I got up this morning. I had breakfast. I cooked my lunch this morning. I can't eat lunch yet. This is what Kellan doing to me. I left home this morning. After I dropped off my wife, I said, but no, I ain't have my shoes. Kellan make me forget my shoes home this morning. I had to go back home and get my shoes. That's just to say the influence of a friend in a positive way on an individual. Unfortunately, I wanted to bring him a surprise this morning, but I wanted to bring him when it was ripe. Kellan loves star apples. I remember this year, early on, no, it would have been late last year, the tree started to take on flowers. And the first thing that came to my mind was Kellan. Monday morning, I was outside. I said, what? The star apples start getting big. And I just picture myself, Kellan saying, well, I don't normally tell him it's bearing. I usually just pick a bucket and bring it for him. He usually share it to two or three. I know Mr. Frank likes the same thing too, Landowner. So I'd usually bring a bucket. He used to say, boy, give me the whole bucket. Boy, me sue me and kindness like that. I want the whole bucket. So, you know, when you look at this gentleman, I mean, it is, I can just replay, go on and on and on. From time to time, you would have employees and or who may have different views on different things. And of course, you know, in organizations, there will be challenges. Kellan always said, you see, folks at the border, you know, all of them who think that it's so important, and like they own the airport, tell them, write a letter and resign today, and ask back for the work tomorrow. See if they go take them back. So, how we express, and again, not just what he says, how he expresses it, it leaves you in awe. He was the individual that you probably might be thinking, we normally think in the box. You might make a decision, or a decision might be made, and you'd say, he just looked at it from a different perspective. He may not always be right, but at least it gives you an opinion from somebody outside. So it helps you in your decision making. And again, too, you might make decisions. How you get it across to staff or to persons on the outside, Kellan gave you that sense of wrongness in that you may be able to think, okay, that's our perspective. How does the one on the outside get it? And again, that's one of the positive traits I'd say of him. He loved good quality work. He was skilled, and I believe he liked to give credit where credit is due. Kellan was an unofficial quality control employee. Countless times, his team or other departments would carry out work, and he may not necessarily like the quality or how it's done. He said, "Fusa, come." He said, "Expo," he said, "they might do something. Look what they're doing on." He said, "Go and watch it. Go and watch it. Just go and watch it." And I say, "Well, no, Kellan, that ain't looking good." He said, "What?" He said, "I tell him that's an airport. That's an international airport. They're crazy." So while he may not necessarily have the skill to do that particular job, he had an eye for good quality work. Even when he did something, his supervisor, he looked at it, he said, "I did this, I did that. You go and watch it and tell me if you're satisfied." Why? Because he wants to make sure that what he does is done to satisfaction and is done to quality. He had a good appreciation for that. And again, in forums like these, I always tend to say, and I'll say it countless times and repeatedly, that when persons pass on, when persons leave the organization, let us take a page from the book and let us try to do as good as. Let the younger employees understand and try to pattern themselves. And when persons, as I say, pass on, and I believe there's so much that we can learn from Kellan's experience. I am not standing here painting a picture that he was perfect. However, that the positive way outshines whatever shortcomings we have. We are all humans. Kiel, that is Kellan's pride and joy. He said to me as a friend, "Ben, I did not have the opportunity to be as educated as I'd like to be." He said, "Well, you know what? Kiel, Kiel, come with that stupidity." And he always said, "Beyond kindness, we want Kiel to do this. Kiel has to do that. He has to do that." Why? He loves, he appreciates, and he really was looking forward to seeing his son develop. From Form 1 to Form 5, he kept us, he didn't speak not just to me alone. I'd say, in particular, to the maintenance team and the extended airport family, his son's development, well, even pre-secondary school, Kellan was looking forward, and at least God gave him the privilege to see Kiel has left secondary school, and he is now pursuing some studies. Kiel, I want to implore on you to continue working hard. So far, you've done pretty well. Your dad will be very proud of you, and I think we as an airport family are proud of you thus far. Kanis, of course, I know you'll be proud of Kiel, and I know you've done a lot to get him to where he is. And, well, today certainly would not be the last day. We as an airport family would be reaching out to you. I know a lot of times people come, people die, come to a happy hour, come to prayers, and after that, life continues. I'm not saying we have to sit mourn. I don't want you to sit and mourn for the rest of your life. We have to move on. However, I think we as a family here, and I say family not as the airport, the villagers, the well-wishers, sympathizers, ought to continue to reach out to the family and support them in the best way possible. I wanted to share another soft moment, but before I even go on to that, if I do at all, Ms. Charles, although I knew you from Sam CC and prior to that, your name also rang a bell from Kellon's mouth because of your close ties with his wife. And I say that to say he's always speaking of his family and the close relationships with extended persons. Of course, Mr. Nimrod, you're here. It's a soft note. It's a pity who I'm about to give a soft comment about is not here. Of course, politics was a part of the ongoing debate over the 20-something years we've been friends. Kellon once said, all who talking about the PM, who ain't like him, who dislike him, he say, everybody freedom, priest, pastor, lawyer, whoever. He say, you me, I'll just talk about him when I'm ready to, but you think if you come here now, I'm going to shake your hand? And I say this to say, that despite we may have different views or we might debate on different topics, we are all humans, we are all Grenadians, and we ought to live together as one. Let us appreciate our time that God has provided us on this earth and enjoy it. We never know when our time would come. And I want to repeat myself, let us try to be as good and as to each other as we can be, and to be as positive as we can be. Thank you. Amen.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Forsyth. I will now call on Mr. Sterling Campbell to come and give his tribute, please.
A pleasant good evening, everyone. I just want to encourage the family. I just want you to keep holding on. Kellon was a great guy, and I am sure, I am quite positive that God would have been merciful unto him, and we're going to see him again. So this little song, People Like You. If you give a little more than you take, and if you try to fix more than you break, if you're the kind who takes the time to help a stranger in the rain, there's a place for people like you. If you stand up for those down on their knees, and if you lend a helping hand to those who can't speak, if you shine a little light, give sight to the ones who lost their way, there's a place for people like you. I've heard up there this. I apologize. Sorry about that. I apologize. Yeah. I believe when.
When your days hung here a true place up there for people like you. If you walk around, if you walk around with your heart out on your sleeve, and if you try to be the change you want to see, if you lay down your life for love so someone could be saved, there's a place for people like you. I've heard. Thank you so much. Sing with me here. Yeah. And when you get there, there's a hand to hold. I believe there's a place for you. Place for people like you. Oh, let's sing it all together. I've heard of the things of old. And when you get there, there's a hand to hold. I believe there's a miracle out there for people like you. And for those who are here, just keep doing the good you do, for there is a place for people like you.
Thank you very much, Celine. Wonderful rendition. People like you. The final tribute will be one in video. Kellon, as well as the Batiste family's son, they are attached to the Constantine Methodist Church. And Kiel is very active within the youth organization, and as such, they have decided to do a video tribute. So, technician, it's up to you. Thank you. Turn over for the officials ceremony to the minister of the church. Okay, final viewing, please, for the family and anyone before the minister comes will be greatly appreciated. While the viewing is taking place, persons standing very close proximity to the door, you are hamburging those at the back from actually seeing some of the proceedings. So I'm making a plea for you to please either go on the side a bit and let those at the back see what's happening to the front, please.
Thank you. 1, 2.
Good afternoon, everyone. We are about to proceed with the service. We are just awaiting just a few moments for things to settle down a bit. Let me invite everyone to stand as we begin at this time.
I am the resurrection and the life, says the Lord. He who believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And whosoever lives and believes in me shall never die.
The hour is coming, and now is, when the dead will hear the voice of the Lord, the Son of God, and those who hear will live.
We brought nothing into this world, and it is certain that we will carry nothing out. The Lord gave, and the Lord takes away. Blessed be the name of the Lord.
If we live to the Lord. And if we die, we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end, Christ died and lived again, that he might be Lord, both of the dead
and of the living.
Our Savior Christ abolished death and brought life and immortality to light through the gospel.
I am the first and the last. I am he who lives and was dead. And I am alive forevermore. And I hold the keys of death and of hell. Because I live, you will live also. And death will be no more. Neither shall there be mourning or crying or pain, for the first things have been passed away.
Amen.
Amen. We remain standing as we sing the hymn, How Great Thou Art. But just before we begin to sing, I would like to remind us that we are still experiencing the COVID regulations to a great extent. I want to urge all of us to wear a mask and to hand sanitize as necessary. And even though we are not in a position to adhere strictly to the distancing of 3 feet, let us remember our brothers and sisters, and that we are one another's keeper. So let us be mindful about that as we go forward. Let us sing the hymn, How Great Thou Art. O Lord my God, when I am in awesome wonder.
O Lord my God,
sings my soul, my Savior God to thee. How great thou art, how great. Dancing my soul,
dancing my soul, my Savior God to thee.
How great thou art, how great thou art.
Dancing my soul,
dancing my soul, my Savior God to thee.
How great thou art, how great thou art.
And when I think that God is a not fearing, send him to die, and scared can take it.
That on the cross,
that on the cross, my burden gladly bearing,
He bled and died to take away my.
Then sing my soul.
Then sing my soul. My Savior God to thee. How great thou art.
How great thou art.
How great thou.
Then sing my soul.
Then sing my soul. My Savior God to thee. How great thou art. How great thou art. When Christ shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim how great.
Then sing my soul.
Then sing my soul. My Savior God to thee. How great thou art.
How great thou.
How great thou art.
Then sing my soul.
Then sing my soul. My Savior God to thee. How great thou art. How great thou art.
Seated, if you can. Let us pray. Most gracious God, we turn to you in this, the sorrow and grief of our bereavement, praying that we may find the strength we need in your sustaining grace, so that even as we mourn the death of one whom we knew and loved, we may not be overcome by this trial, but that we may hold fast, trusting in your goodness and mercy. Assure us, O Lord, our God, that death is not the end of those who trust in you. And may our hearts be so composed in the Holy Spirit that all fear and bitterness may be swallowed up in the light and peace you give to your troubled children through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Almighty and eternal God, who by the Holy Spirit minister to us in our weaknesses, and by the victory of your Son, Jesus Christ, have given us the pledge of eternal life. Lift us, we pray, above our present distress and sorrow, and shed the light of your grace and glory upon us through the same Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. We sing a medley of songs, beginning with The Goodness of God. It is raining all around me, and Jehovah, you are the Most High God. Medley of songs.
I love you, Lord, for your mercy never failed me. All my life, I am held in the air. From the moment I am here, the All my life we have been fed. Of your goodness, of God, I love your voice. You have led me to the fire. In darkness and night, all across the night, the word. I've known you as a friend. I know you as a friend. I have lived the goodness of God.
All my life you've been faithful.
All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so good.
Every breath that I am ever, oh, I can sing of the goodness of God. Goodness is running out, it's running out for me. Your goodness is running out, it's running after me. My life laid down, drowned and numb, I give you everything. Your goodness is running out, it's running after me.
All my life.
All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. Every breath that I am faithful, I will sing of your goodness of God.
All my life.
All my life you have. All my life you have been so good. Every breath I have ever had, oh, I can see of the goodness of God. I can see of the goodness of God.
God is good all the time.
Amen. We'll always sing of the goodness of God.
Okay. It is raining.
It is raining all around me. I can feel it. It's a lot of,
lot
of rain. Give us more rain until we are wet, and we are till we are, and we are so in a lot of rain.
One more time, it's raining.
It is.
It is raining
all around me. It's a lot,
lot
of rain. Ride on Jesus, give us more rain until we are, and we are, till we are, and we are so in a lot of rain. Lord, that God. Yeah, the works of man. But you, it's nothing.
Yadaka. They are the works of man. They are none like you. The Most High. You are the Most High. Jehovah, you are the Most High. You are the Most High God. Only other God. Are the works of man. Alone of God. There ain't none like you. Only other God. They are the works of man. There is none like you. You are the Most High. You are the Most High God. You are the Most High. You are the Most High God.
God is good all the time.
God is good. It's good.
Kindly be seated. Let's be as quiet as possible. From within and without, be as quiet as possible as we pay our last respect to our departed brother, Kellen Baptiste. We are met in this solemn moment to commend Kellen Baptiste into the hands of the Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who sent his Son Jesus Christ to be our Redeemer, by whose stripes we are healed, and in whose name only we have salvation. Let us then call to mind the life of the deceased brother in humble trust. Hear the words of Holy Scripture. But before we have the reading from the Scripture, I'd like to, at this point, recognize the wife of deceased Kellen, Sister Canis Pascal Baptiste, his son, Brother K.L. Baptiste, his siblings, his in-laws, his father-in-law, his nieces and nephews, aunts and uncles, close friends and relatives, the management and staff of the Airport Authorities of Grenada, especially the Maintenance Department, and all those who are here to pay our last respect in the service of thanksgiving for Brother Kellen Baptiste, deceased. And so with this recognition, we then will listen attentively. We listen attentively to the eulogy. And the eulogy today will be delivered by Pastor Rosemary Antoine Lewis. Pastor Antoine Lewis.
The eulogy of Kellen Jude Baptiste. Sunrise, Saturday, 9th May, 1917. Sunset, Wednesday, the 2nd February, 2022. Final farewell upon this earth, Thursday, 24th February, 2022. I give honor to the Lord, who is the head of my life, Reverend Lystra Craig Duncan, fellow ministers of the gospel, caretaker of the New National Party, Mr. Nimrod Olivier, the widow, son, and family of Kellon Jude Batiste, the entire community of Willis, New Hampshire, and surrounding areas. Family, friends, near and abroad. I greet you in no other name except the name of our soon returning Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. I am standing before you to give the eulogy of a well-loved and cherished soul, Kellon Jude Batiste, a.k.a. Massop, affectionately referred to by all. Kellon Jude Batiste, a.k.a. Massop of New Hampshire, St. George's, was born to Thomas Murrell and Joyce Batiste on Saturday, 9th May, 1917. He was the brother of Smith, Elaine, Carol, Rennie, Kenny, Eon, Clement, Sheldon, Emma, and Ian. Kellon met the love of his life at a very young age, in the year 1990. Cornice recalled, the very first time he approached me, he came with two friends, Gavin and Troy. He was shy at the time, so he needed backup. He said he wanted to have a few words with me. I smiled, and my heart started to beat extra fast. He told me he liked me a lot, and long time he was looking at me. The first 2 years in our relationship was not easy. The sneaking, the licks. Many times I lied to my mom, telling her my Saturday classes finishing very late. Or I snuck out to go to the beach. Or even telling her I'm going by Auntie Janice when she was out, just to get a chance to be with him. My grandmother, Hilda Pascal, always had my back because she loved Kellon. He always came by to help her do things on the house with the intention of seeing me. I remembered my mom told me to leave him. That was the first time I displayed rudeness to her. I told her I will never. She hit me a lash of bottle on my mouth to the extent that my lip cut. But the relationship between Kellon and I continued to grow stronger, so strong that 32 years later, we were and are still deeply in love. In February 2002, he told me he was ready to start his family. I didn't know his intention, but during that month, I started feeling sick. I told him I missed my monthly. he smiled and told me he knows what he did. Thursday, November 28, 2002, our son Kiel came into this world. The bond between them was unbreakable since birth. Kiel fondly remembers his dad bringing him to the airport since at the age of four, a father-son tradition that continued up until January 2021. Kiel gives his dad credit for his acquired cooking skills. All the time they spend making soup with five different types of meat: pig snout, pig feet, chicken wings, turkey wings, and saltfish. The soup gave them strength to wrestle each other. Cornice was referred to as the bias referee because she always ruled in Kiel's favor. Kellon would say, "You're only taking your son's side." That was family time for him. Kiel is the man he is today because of Kellon. Kiel says, "Daddy dropped me to school every day of my life and taught me to drive." We share the same taste in music, Lucky Dubie and reggae. His last words to me were, "I'm very, very proud of you. Me and your mother," and he dozed off. Kellon was very giving. He wasn't greedy. He loved to share. He would give his last dollar to help someone. If anyone needed a job, all they had to do was ask him. Kellon would find one for them. It is said that his ability to find a job for someone was his blessings. He loved all his siblings. His sister Elaine recalled the time her father ordered her to leave the house. Who could she count on? None other than Kellon. She distinctly remembers him helping her pack her clothes, then dropping her in Sawa in the middle of the night. Is there any doubt how important family was to Kellon? Certainly not. He always put his family first and demonstrated this by his commitment to looking out for them in good times and bad. He was closest to Eon from since their childhood days. Every time they left work, the first stop was Mr. Lydon's bar at the airport. On their way up, they stopped off by Mr. St. Bob's to have a drink. Then to Money Mice bar, and the final stop, owner's shop before home. Kellon was a realistic and a plain speaker. Cornice remembers him saying, "If you don't get your subjects, I will leave you. I don't want a dunce wife and a dunce child." Two dunce parents cannot raise a bright child. He also said, growing up, the meat had to share for everybody. Now, I could afford to get a whole corned beef for myself or a whole ham. They say it ain't good to eat. Kellon loved life and brought levity to every situation. On one occasion, he was approached by a police officer who asked him to provide his name for a ticket. Kellon responded, "Akule Moses." The officer asked, "How do you spell that?" Kellon replied, "You asking me? I don't even know how to spell my own name." The policeman had no choice but to let him go on. Kellon was not afraid to express his opinions, and when he said what he had to say, he finished off with, "Go and say what Massa say. Don't tell them anybody else said it." One thing, you could not argue with him. Even though he knew he was wrong, he was still challenged to the end. He loved agriculture, always growing food and raising chicken to provide for his family. He also loved sports, especially cricket, with his favorite being the Australian cricket team. And who could be depended on to collect the provision and breadfruit for the Independence oil down cooks up on the airport? Kellon. For the 20 plus years he worked at the airport, he was known and respected for being dependable and industrious. Soon, he would have been working alongside his son, who often reminded him, "Daddy, I will be dropping you to work just now, and you will be following my instructions for once when I give you the go-ahead to cross the runway." Kellon lived a full life, and he loved every second of it. He touched the life of anyone he came into contact with. He was jovial, energetic, kind-hearted, loyal, helpful, supportive, hard-working, and honest. This is the full life lived by our beloved Kellon Massup Batisse. We say farewell, Massup. Thank you, and God bless each and every one of you.
So we have heard the eulogy as delivered by Pastor Rosemary Antoine Lewis. This will be followed by a special rendition by Mrs. Corinne Campbell, and then, of course, we'll have a tribute by K.L. Batiste, our brother K.L., as we know, the son of deceased
Kellon Baptiste. But first we'll have the special rendition by Miss Corinne Cameron.
Isaiah 41 says that the Lord reassures us that he will always be with you. He will never leave you nor forsake you. No matter what you're facing, he knows. He is El Roi, the God who sees you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Where feet may fail, and there I find you in the mystery, in oceans deep, my faith will stand, and I will call upon your name. And keep my eyes above the waves. When oceans rise, my soul will rest in your embrace. For I am yours, and you are mine. Your grace abounds in deepest waters. Your sovereign hand will be my guide. Where feet may fail and fear surrounds me, you never fail and you won't start now. Call upon your name and keep my eyes above the waves. When oceans rise, my soul will rest in your embrace. For I am yours and you are mine. Let me walk upon the waters, wherever you would call me, and take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith will become stronger in the presence of my Savior. And Spirit leads me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters,
wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith will become stronger in the presence of my Savior. And Spirit leads me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters wherever you will call me. And take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. Oh, Jesus, your name, and keep my eyes above the waves. When oceans rise, my soul will rest in your embrace, for I am yours, and you are mine. Felt like I just couldn't take life anymore. My problems had me bound. Depression weighed me down, but God held me close, so I wouldn't let go. God's mercy kept me, so I wouldn't let go. I almost let go. I felt like I just couldn't take life anymore. My problems had me bound. Depression weighed me down, but God held me close, so I wouldn't let go. God's mercy kept me, so I wouldn't let go. Say, I will call upon your name and keep my eyes above the waves. When oceans rise, my soul will rest in your embrace, for I am yours, and you are mine.
Now we invite Kiel to the microphone as he brings his tribute.
This one is for you, Daddy. My hero, You held my hand when I was small. You caught me when I fell. You are the hero of my childhood. And in my latter years as well. Every time I think of you, my heart still fills with pride. Though I'll always miss you, Dad, I know you're always by my side. In laughter and in sorrow, in sunshine and in rain, I know you're watching me until we meet again. Thank you.
We give God thanks for the courage and the ability he has given to KL to bring this tribute to his dad. I believe that's the last that he will do for his dad. And we give God thanks for such gift and ability at this time. We turn now to the reading of the Holy Scriptures, and we would first of all have a reading from Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 1 through to 13, and it will be read by Kishel Anderson, and that will be followed by the hymn, I'll Fly Away, Kishel Anderson. Ecclesiastes 3, 1 to 13.
Good afternoon, church. The scripture reading is taken from Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 1 to 13. And it reads, "For everything there is a season and a time for every matter under heaven. A time to be born and a time to die. A time to plant and a time to pluck what is planted. A time to kill and a time to heal. A time to break down and a time to build up. A time to weep and a time to laugh. A time to moan and a time to dance. A time to throw away stones and a time to gather stones together. A time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing. A time to seek and a time to lose. A time to keep and a time to throw away. A time to tear and a time to sow. A time to keep silence and a time to speak. A time to love and a time to hate. A time for war and a time for peace. What gain have the workers from their toil? I have seen the business that God has given to everyone to be busy with. He has made everything suitable for its time. Moreover, he has put a sense of past and future into the minds, yet they cannot find out what God has done from the beginning to the end. I know that there is nothing better for them than to be happy and enjoy themselves as long as they live. Moreover, it is God's gift that all shall eat and drink and make and take pleasure in all their toil." This is the scripture reading. Amen.
Thanks be to God.
To John chapter 14, reading from verse 1 through to verse 6 and verse 27. Glory to you, O God. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house, there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, I would not have told you I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. And if I go to prepare a place where I'm going, then Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you're going. How can we know the way? Jesus said to him, I am the way. And the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Verse 27, peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not let them be afraid.
This is the gospel of Christ. Praise be to Christ, our Lord. Amen. Please be seated.
The reading from the gospel just read was done by Reverend Lister Craig Duncan, who is the minister with pastoral responsibility for this congregation here at New Hampshire. Thank you, Rev.
Welcome, sir.
And now we are at the point where we're going to have youthful voices, and we are asking the youth choir to do the rendition. Oh, all right, sorry about that. It's just mix up in terms of the position in which they come. So I now invite our superintendent minister, the Reverend, our superintendent minister, I beg your pardon, Reverend Silbert Prescott, to bring to us, as God laid on his heart, the message which is referred to here as the homily. Reverend Prescott.
Thank you, Pastor Leonard Julian, who also is one of our lay pastors who has some responsibilities along with Reverend Craig Duncan in this particular congregation. Let me take this opportunity to greet one and all as we gather this evening to pay our last respects to Brother Kellon Baptiste. I want to particularly extend condolences on behalf of the Methodist Church here in Grenada to the family of the deceased, Sister Cornice, and as well Brother Keel, who is the son of the deceased. We want to assure you that indeed you are in our prayers, and we continue to hold you in our hearts and in our thoughts as you mourn the loss of someone who was near and dear to your hearts. This evening, I want to invite us to reflect for a few moments on a passage taken from Matthew chapter 10, verse 29. It reads, "Are not two sparrows sold for a penny? Yet not one of them fall to the ground except your Father. Even the hairs on your head are numbered. So do not be afraid. You are of more value than they." Let me take that again. "Are not two sparrows sold for a penny? Yet not one of them fall to the ground apart from your Father. Even the hairs on your head are counted. So do not be afraid. You are of more value than they." Let us pray. Gracious and eternal God, we ask that your Holy Spirit will be with us as we reflect on your word at this time. So speak to me and speak through me, and may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen and amen. What is life? What is the purpose and worth of life? You know, death forces us to think and to contemplate the value of life. And whenever death comes close to us, whenever death touches home to us, it causes us to ponder the meaning and the value of life. And it is in such moments that we are tempted, or the words of the Apostle James comes to mind when he says, "For what is life? It is but a vapor. It appeareth for a little while, and then it vanishes away." I mean, it doesn't matter how someone dies or when they do. But whenever we attend a funeral and we see the body of a life that was full before us. It forces us to look at life from a new perspective. It reminds us how fragile we are as human beings. It reminds us of the temporary nature of this life that we live. It reminds us that rich or poor, good or bad, each of us is someday going to die. We don't know when, we don't know how, but the truth is, death eventually will come to all. In other words, death in some ways seems to cheapen life. And as we think of life, in a sense, the words of the psalmist resounds in our mind as he says, "As for man, his days are as grass, as a flower of the field, so he flourishes. For the wind passes over him, and he is gone." Yes, friends, death forces us to reevaluate the worth of life. And to be honest, in the midst of death, sometimes we are forced to conclude or concur with the words of Ecclesiastes, which says, "Vanity of vanities, all is vanity. Our days here under the sun are yet but nothing before God." Indeed, death cheapens life. It threatens to rob life of its glory. But when we are tempted to think that life is all about living and dying and being forgotten, Jesus takes this notion and he turns it on its head. When we think that life is nothing, Jesus says, "No, life is worth much more than that." In the face of death, when life seems to be reduced to nothing, Jesus gives life its full meaning and purpose. In our text from Matthew chapter 10, verse 29, Jesus calls his disciples and he is sending them out. He tells them not to seek protection or not to gather possessions. However, he warns them that the journey ahead is going to be a difficult one. Verse 16 sets the context for that mission. It says, "See, I am sending you out like a sheep among wolves. You will face challenges. You will face persecution. You will face hostility. You will face death. But don't fear." I don't know about you, friends, but whenever someone tells me don't be afraid or don't fear, that is exactly when I know that there is something out there to be afraid of. And this is exactly the case with Jesus and his disciples, because the whole situation surrounding them was shrouded with fear and anxiety. Their entire lives were threatened, and death was looming on the horizon for them. But rather than harboring thoughts of fear of what is going to happen to them, Jesus reminds them that they can trust him and believe in him in every moment. He assures them, "You may suffer. You may experience hardship. Challenges might be all around you. You might be confronted with even death." But death does not have the last word with Jesus, because he reminds us that Jesus is the resurrection and the life. Friends, death does not reduce the value of life in God's sight, because death is not the end of those who trust in Jesus. Death might destroy the body, but it cannot destroy the soul, and only God alone can do that. And God values every soul. I want us to pay some close attention to what Jesus says in these verses. Listen to the assurances he gives the disciples, when they were thinking that they would be left alone to face their challenges, as orphans, Jesus says, are not two sparrows sold for a penny? Yet not one of them fall to the ground apart from your Father. And even the hairs on your head are counted. So don't be afraid. You are of more value than many sparrows, as Luke puts it. Brothers and sisters, this text is rich with meaning and purpose in the midst of life. It gives us the assurance that our dear brother Kellen's life is not forgotten by God. It gives us the assurance that when death comes and loss surrounds us, we can trust in God in the midst of death. It assures us that nothing happens outside the will and purpose of God, who is in control of all things. It reminds us most of all that the God who cares for the sparrows is the God who cares for us. You know, I spend a lot of time in Guyana. And one of the things, not a lot of time, about a year or so, I noted about the Guyanese people is that they had a special affinity to birds. You saw them walking around with cages everywhere, with little birds in them. And that tells me something. That the birds that they were carrying around had a lot of value. But when I read this passage, it seems to be unlike the birds that Jesus is speaking about here. Because these birds in this text seems to be dirt cheap. Because Jesus says you could get two of them for a penny. Two birds for a penny. But listen to this. This is the weight and the strength of this passage. These sparrows that were cheap on the market, that were nothing, despite their little value, Jesus says, not one of them falls to the ground apart from God's love and God's control. Luke puts it even more beautifully. He says, no sparrow is forgotten by God. Therefore, if every little sparrow that falls to the ground and dies is on the heart of God, if God knows how every sparrow feels, the pain and the struggles that it goes through, if our Lord knows exactly every single sparrow and the challenges that they are faced with, if a sparrow which is of little value is not forgotten by God, if every little sparrow receives God's constant care and attention, what about you and me, who are of much more value than these sparrows? Does God care about us, is the question, when we experience pain and loss? Does God really care what we are going through in the midst of loss? The songwriter assures us, friends, that he does. The songwriter puts it this way. He says, oh yes, he cares. I know he cares. His heart is touched with my grief and my woe. When the days are weary and the long nights are dreary, I know my Redeemer cares. My dear sister and brother, I assure you, as you mourn the loss of your loved one, God cares. The God who watches the sparrow is the God who watches over you and shelters you under his loving arms. And because God cares for you, we know that the days ahead is going to be difficult. But in the presence of God, there is always hope. We know that there might be many questions that remain unanswered for you at this time. But in God's presence, we are never left without hope. You know, I cannot say that I know the deceased Kellyanne Baptiste very well. But one thing I can say, I know his son fairly well. And if the character and attitude of his son is anything by which we can measure the Father, well, there must be something there. Because you wouldn't meet a more pleasant, focused, and committed young man as our dear young brother Kiel. Indeed, Kellan is gone. For his friends, he was a good companion, someone who they can always trust and look to in times of difficulty. To his co-workers, he was a faithful and hard-working man. To his family, he was someone who was always there and cared for each of them deeply. And in a sense, for each of you, he will be missed. There is nothing that we can say or do that can fill the space that you are feeling in your heart right now. But I know that there is someone who is able to understand and read the language of the tears that are in your heart. It is that man who cares for the sparrows. So even as you mourn, even as you mourn your loss, let us find assurance in the comfort that God cares for us. That the compassionate God reaches out to touch us even in the midst of our sorrow. Brothers and sisters, God does not forget even one little sparrow. And God does not forget you either. God does not forget any life that he created. If God valued the life of the sparrow, how much more does God value his human children who he made in his own image and likeness? It means that, like a good parent, God have a grand vision for all of his children. God's kindness and mercy and peace is always there for us when we suffer pain and sorrow. It means that every detail of our lives are known by God, that nothing happens to us that God does not know about. And there is nothing that God is unable to do for us when we trust in him. As Matthew puts it, all the hairs on our heads are numbered. In other words, God knows the smallest details of our lives. He knows us personally, and he cares for us even in our deepest burdens. He cares what happens to us. Moreover, my brothers and sisters, God's love, God's care does not prevent the sparrow from falling to the ground. And neither will God's love or God's care and God's compassion for us will stop difficulties from happening. We may face difficulties, but we have a God who has promised us that he will never leave us or forsake us, but that he will be with us even to the close of the age. And that is the assurance that Jesus gives to us in these moments. You know, there is a story about a Christian woman called Camilla Martin. And as she ministered in a particular church, there was an old man who lost his wife at a very young age. And after he lost his wife, he was inflicted with a disease that crippled him. And he went about everywhere he went, he was jolly and he was happy even though he suffered such loss. And whenever he was looking happy, even in the midst of sadness, people would always ask him, "Why are you so happy and life is so difficult?" And the man was always comment, "God is watching the sparrows." They would look at him and they would say, "Well, I know that life is difficult, but why are you smiling? Why do you seem so happy?" He will say, "God is watching the sparrows." And this lady, Camilla Martin, when she was going through a difficult season in her own life, she remembered that old man who always commented, whenever he was faced with difficulties, that God is watching the sparrows. God is watching the sparrows. And in her pain and in her suffering, she sat down and she penned these wonderful words, which says, "Why should my heart feel discouraged? Why should the shadows come? Why should my heart be lonely and long for heaven's home? When Jesus is my portion, a constant friend is he. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me." Brothers and sisters, Matthew reminds us that none of us are outside the watchful eyes of our Heavenly Father. Therefore, even in death and trials, even in the midst of those things, we can have hope, because the God who is watching the sparrows is the God who is watching over us. And that is the hope we have today. So friends, God cares. God care for us and love for us does not prevent our families from dying. But it does not mean that God loves us any less. So in the midst of your sorrow and difficulties, I pray that you will hold on to this God who cares for the sparrows and who cares for you even more. So may you know the strength and the love and the comfort of this God as you mourn today. May he sustain you and strengthen you as you mourn. And may you find strength each day to live, knowing that death is not the end of those who trust in Jesus. So friends, the God who is watching this sparrow is the God who holds us in his hands. So let us continue to trust this God. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen and amen. We pause for a few moments as we ponder those words. Reverend, let me invite you now to stand as we share together in the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord.
He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again.
He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead.
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins,
the resurrection of the body,
and the life everlasting. Amen. Amen.
God bless you. Please be seated, everyone.
We now continue as we go to God in prayer, as you have the prayers of thanksgiving. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Praise be to you, O God, our Father, who created us in your own image for eternal fellowship with you. Praise and thanksgiving to you, O Christ, our Lord and our God, who have overcome the sharpness of death and opened the kingdom of heaven to all believers, and are now still at the right hand of God in the glory of the Father. Praise and blessing be to you, Holy Spirit, God our Comforter, who bears witness within us of our acceptance with the Father and have become the pledge of our inheritance. All praise and glory, blessing and honor, thanksgiving and worship be to you, O blessed Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen. We bless your name, for
for the life of him whom we today lay to rest. We give a thanks to the joy and the blessing his life has brought to others, for his service to his generation according to your will, and for every happy remembrance of his life. We bless you for your mercy and goodness, which have followed him all the days of his life. And now, the trials of this world are over, and death itself is past. Receive him into your perfect kingdom, and bring us with all who have lived and served you faithfully to the fullness of your eternal joy, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen and amen. Okay, we stand as we sing our next hymn. We continue. Okay, great is thy faithfulness, O Lord, O God. We all will stand and sing together. She will not have paper. No, sir. I take the white paper. The white piece.
Great is thy faithfulness,
O God, my Father.
seated as we continue in prayer. Yes, sir. Eternal God, who have made us and hate nothing that you have made, and have given your son for our redemption, we commend our brother, Kellon, to your perfect mercy and wisdom. Eternal rest grant unto him, and let perpetual light shine upon him. We continue as we pray the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen and amen. We now have the grace, and after we now have the recessional. So can we have the pose? Okay. Before we have the grace, we now have ask a family member who will come to appreciate thanks. And then we have the benediction and then the recessional.
Pleasant good afternoon to everyone. The family of Cornice Pascal Batiste wishes to express heartfelt thanks to the many friends, neighbors, and well-wishers for the expressions of sympathy and gestures of kindness shown to us following our sad loss. Thank you for every prayer, every phone call, every visit, and every meal. We appreciate all of you for the emotional and practical support provided to us at this difficult time. For those of you who have traveled long distances, sent floral arrangements, cards, and messages of condolences, as well as those of you who did tributes and made charitable donations, we are truly grateful. A special vote of thanks to Reverend Prescott, Reverend Lystra Craig Duncan, Pastor Julian, Mr. and Mrs. Lewis, Margaret Goodin, and members of the Methodist Church, Mrs. Joan Gilbert, General Manager of the Grenada Airport Authority, Mr. Nimrod Oliver, the New National Party caretaker for the St. George Northeast constituency, Mrs. Cheryl Courtney, the Batiste family, the Pascal family, the Gooding family, the Morrell family in Texas, Roger Bridgman and family, Von Darius, Alroy Paris, Judy and Jermaine, Kesey Cadet and family, Melissa Jones Gittens, Auntie Janice, Martha Franklin, Patrice Julian, Marcia Frederick, Julian Bain, Amani Waldron, and finally, the Lacroix Brother Burial Funeral Home for their sensitive and professional handling of the funeral arrangements. Finally, to all those of you who helped in any way, your contributions made our loss more bearable. As it would be impossible to thank everyone individually, please accept this acknowledgement as an expression of our gratitude. Thank you. And just by way of announcement, after the burial, we have light refreshments at Brownie's Hideaway, so please feel free to come out and just, you know, be with us. Thank you.
Just to give us something to put on.
Yes, sir. Got no song, eh? Okay. So we sing Hear My Cry, O Lord, the first verse. And then we have a benediction. And then we have the rest, the recessional.
today. Oh, and my heart is overwhelmed. Lead me to the rock that is higher than, higher, higher.
Now and forevermore. Amen.
Amen. Amen.